chapter 18, that you are able in heart and mind, let us stand together and be called to worship. Those who heard this said, then who can be saved?
Jesus replied, what is impossible for humans is possible for God.
Peter said, look, we left everything we own and followed you.
Jesus said to him, I assure you that anyone who has left a house, husband, wife, brothers, sisters, parents, or children, because of God's kingdom, will receive many times more in this age and eternal life in the coming age.
With this in mind, let us sing together our hymn of praise, which comes to us from the Glory to God hymnal. It's to Abraham and Sarah. You can find it on page 6 in your guides to worship. We give you great thanks, O God, that you hear us and you always answer. Amen. So God is at work not only in people that we think are godly, but in all of us who think we are not. The Spirit of God is still changing hearts and fashioning the world. My brothers and sisters in Christ, believe the good news of the gospel.
Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
So the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
The peace of Christ be with us all.
Amen.
God expressing commitment to the covenant. listen for the word of God to us all. Abraham fell on his face and laughed. He said to himself, can a 100-year-old man become a father? Or Sarah, a 90-year-old woman, have a child? To God, Abraham said, if only you would accept Ishmael. But God said, no, your wife Sarah will give birth to a son for you, and you will name him Isaac. Or he laughs. I will set up my covenant with him and with his descendants after him as an enduring covenant. As for Ishmael, I have heard your request. I will bless him and make him fertile and give him many, many descendants. He will be the ancestor of 12 tribal leaders, and I will make a great nation of him. But I will set up my covenant with Isaac, who will be born to Sarah at this time next year. When God finished speaking to him, God ascended, leaving Abraham alone. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let me invite any children forward for the children's sermon. All right, guys. Good morning. So let me ask you a question. Do you know what a tree is?
Christmas.
And Henry, let me say, I am very glad for your focus. But yes, a tree. So what are the parts of a tree?
Ornaments.
Ornaments? Yeah, all right. What else? What are the parts of a tree?
Leaves.
Leaves. Branches.
Wood.
You forgot?
Wood.
Okay. What else?
And the trunk.
The trunk? What about the bark?
And
it's the skin of the tree, that bark.
And grasses.
Grasses? I'm not sure about that. We can talk about that one, though. What else? What else is part of the tree?
Sometimes.
Moss, sometimes.
Sticks.
Yeah. So there are a lot of different parts of the tree, right? But now, let me ask you this. How does a tree drink? Do you know that?
From the bottom of the tree.
From the bottom of the tree, the roots, right? Yeah, that's how it drinks. It doesn't really drink it from the sky. It waits for it to get into the ground, and then it drinks it up from the ground, right? And do you always see the roots of the tree?
No.
Well, then how do you know trees have roots? Yeah, but if you can't see them, how can they be real? Uh-huh. Oh, well, then you'd see it then, right? But if you can't see them, then they're not real, right?
They're not underground.
Yeah. Thing is, the roots are there even when we can't see them, aren't they? Just like the sun is there even when we're sleeping at night. Just like the air is there even though we can't see it coming into our bodies. And just like God's love and promise are there for us even though we can't always feel it, or see it, or smell it, or taste it. And so, when you get home, and you're with the people who care about you, I want you to talk with them about how to trust in God's promises. Can you do that? Can you try that? Just like the roots of a tree. You need to drink them in. Let's pray.
Dear God.
Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
Help me, God.
Change me, God.
Help others, God.
Thank you, God.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, y'all. Everybody, second grade number can go to junior church. They make it a point to say she is well beyond childbearing years. You know what that means, don't you? Menopause. Okay, I thought we were scientists, but that's okay. We'll catch up. But, so here it is. They are faced with how to make these promises come true. And in their efforts to do so, they run into some very real human emotions, don't they? They deal with anxiousness. And out of that, they try and enact different schemes, especially when Abraham gets caught in a foreign land and is afraid that he's going to get killed because somebody's wanting to take Sarah, and so he passes her off as his sister. Remember that? They do all kinds of things like this out of their anxiousness. And then you got to love their impatience. Now, nobody here nowadays in modern times is impatient, right? No, that's good, because we're enlightened and all that. But in our humanness, we allow our impatience to make us do stupid things. We make dumb decisions because we won't wait. We try to hurry things along. We want things to be done our way right now. And instead of praying for God's will to be done, we kind of want God's will to be our will and make it happen out of things. One of the other things that we do is we get really a God complex. We get this sense that, well, of course, the way I'm thinking about this or my way is the way this should be done or the way that this should be approached. It makes sense to me. I do it all the time. Find myself getting caught up in the things that I think make sense, including the selection of elders. There have been times in my history here where there have been folks that the congregation has elected, and I have said to myself, really? But thankfully, it's not up to me. In our system, Jesus Christ is the head of the church, and that's how our elders get selected. Turns out some of those elders that I had questions about were some of the best ones that we've had. Thank you, Lord, that you still are in charge. Let your will be done. But then, sometimes fear really gets the best of us. Out of our fears, we see things differently. We hear things differently. We say things differently. And then we certainly do things differently than we might if we were brave. We allow our courage to get sucked into the many voices that we listen to or all the things that we think we see, and as a result, we miss what it is that God is really trying to show us. Same thing happens when our greed takes over. In our efforts to try and gather all resources, to try and hedge our bets in this life, we try to hold on to as much as we can, and in the process realize we can hold on to nothing. What is it that Jesus says? How many of you, by worrying, can add a single day to your life? Anybody ever done that before? Yeah, not in history have we ever been able, as humanity, to add time to the clock because we worried about something. It doesn't happen. And yet, out of our greed, we still do that. The other thing that we tend to do is we get too goal-oriented. We get this sense that the end justifies the means. As long as we can get there, does it really matter how we got there? Now, we talk a good game about the fact that, yes, we need to have integrity throughout. But the truth is, we don't always live that way. Sometimes, when we're going into the parking lot, and we're in a hurry, and we cut that person off to get that parking space, well, I'm sorry I did that, but it was really important. I need to get in there. Really? I mean, how many times have we justified our own actions because of something we thought should take priority? Because it made sense to us. You see where this is going, don't you? I mean, it's all leading up to the $64 million question. What is more real? Okay? What you see, what you think you see, or what you believe. Which is more real? What you see, what you think you see, for what you believe. All right? Commit. How many of you think that what you see is what's most real? Okay. How many of you feel like what you think you see is what's most real? Engineers, thank you. Okay. How many of you think that what you believe is what's more real? And for all of you who didn't vote, shame on you. But seriously, we look at these different ways of addressing our reality, and at the end of the day, there are times where all three of these are wrong. Think about what happened to Abraham. It makes sense to him that he's too old to have children. So if he's going to believe in this promise that God has given to him, how is it supposed to work? But what does God say? No. I know what you've done, and I know what you're trying to do with Hagar and with the whole Ishmael thing. That's not the plan. I have a plan in mind for how this is going to work, and I appreciate your efforts. I'm going to take care of Ishmael, but please listen to me, Abraham. Please listen to me, Hawfields. Please listen to me, David. We get this sense that we know better than God how things are supposed to work, and at the end of the day, God is the most real thing in our lives. The reality that God presents to us is the most sure thing in our lives. And the reality that God presents to us is a destiny that we couldn't have possibly come up with on our own. One of the things that I love about how God works, especially in the Old Testament, is God is constantly saying to them, remember, I'm the God of you. God doesn't just stay in the abstract. God always points to concrete actions to justify the demands that God makes on the faithful. God doesn't just say, hey, you need to make some sacrifices. God makes the sacrifice. God doesn't just say, hey, I want you to go there. God goes ahead of us. God doesn't just say, hey, you got to love your neighbor. Newsflash, God loves all of us. Interestingly, God doesn't hold above us anything that God's not willing to do God's own self. And so given this history, given these memories that we should have of how God has been working in our lives and where God is, how is it that we continue to struggle with each other? How is it that we allow our fights to take over our good sense and replace our memories? Fighting so long that we even forget why we're fighting. Did you know that the fact that you men and women are sitting together, that was a fight? You remember that? Any of y'all there for that? No. But it was.
Still there.
How many things can you point to in our present culture in which we're fighting, but we've forgotten all of the reasons? It just feels familiar. It feels right. It makes sense to us. Thus, when you get Ishmael and Isaac's destinies facing up to each other, you've got this conflict set up, and frankly, set up by Abraham in his actions, and Sarah in her actions, and Hagar, and the principles themselves. This idea that now you've got these two destinies that are always going to be at war with each other. It is said that the descendants of Ishmael are the Arab nations, and that the descendant of Isaac is the Jewish nation. And in between are all of us watching the elephants fight. Love this African proverb. When the elephants fight, it's the grass that suffers. And at the end of the day, why are Ishmael and Isaac fighting? Does anybody really remember who started it in Palestine? Anyone? Does anybody remember why the land is configured the way it is? Why the world pays so much attention to this little scratch of land that isn't even as big as Rhode Island? What are we doing? Why are we fighting? It becomes a question of will. We've had this word come up before, and it keeps coming up. We've got Abraham's will. If only God, you would accept Ishmael. You've got Sarah's will. Hey, I'm not having Hagar, even though I set her up and I made her go through all this stuff. You need to banish her. Really? You've got Ishmael, who as a child doesn't have any rights. He's got no control over what happens to him, and so when Abraham banishes him and his mother to the desert, he has no choice in the matter. You've got Hagar, who, remember, was a slave. Her choices were even more narrow than Ishmael's. Because at the end of the day, at least Ishmael could point to the fact that he was Abraham's blood kin. You've got Isaac, a destiny set up even before he was born. Promises that were made to Abraham decades before he even arrived on the scene. Because remember, at this point in the story, Sarah's not even pregnant yet. In the end, even in the midst of all of these conflicts, even in the midst of all the layers of the scheming and all of the layers of understanding and these ideas that seem to make sense to us, God's will be done. God still makes it happen. And I'll prove it. How many of you know what this is? Family tree. How many of you have a family tree? Dude, seriously, we all have a family tree, right? And out of this tree, how far back can you go?
Seven generations.
Eight. Nine. Or ten. Eleven. Anybody go back two generations? And what does knowing about these generations tell you? How does it inform your life? I mean, does knowing about all these generations help you decide what kind of bank account to open? It kind of does. Because if your forebears had a certain mind about money, for example, that's going to carry over into your family. It may not have as much influence over you as maybe it did over them, but it's there. Part of my family hails from the Isle of Scotland. I don't talk that way. I'm pretty sure I don't look Scottish. And yet, knowing that piece of history, I have a sense that I didn't get here on this continent by myself. And neither did they. Their choices impact me now, because if they hadn't come here, I wouldn't be here. Any more than the family, that part of my family that comes from the Ivory Coast on the western edge of Africa. And yet when I look at my family tree, I can go back as many generations as I want to. I can go all the way back to Abraham and Sarah if I want to, and it's still not far enough. Because at the apex of my family tree, if the creation story means anything to me, is God. How many of you, when you filled out your family tree, put God at the top of your tree? Why not? I'm not saying that I'm God's gift. I'm not saying that I'm all that. I'm simply expressing a sense of the reality that may not necessarily make sense on paper. But as a person of faith, I know this. I am an ancestor. I'm an ancestor of God's will. I'm an ancestor of God's promise. So what am I to make of what God wants from me? What am I supposed to do? Well, for one thing, I need to live right. For one thing, I need to be thinking about those who came before me and not consider myself to be morally superior, but to live at my utmost. I need to remember that I'm not always going to get it right, but I owe it to my ancestors to try. Thus, my brothers and sisters in Christ, if you don't do anything else leading today, remember this. We must fail forward. Abraham, by any account, was an imperfect person. Sarah, by any account, was an imperfect person. Any of the rest of their generations were hardly paragons of moral virtue. That's not the trick. The trick is being in the practice of saying yes to God and being willing to do so even if it means getting it wrong so that God can correct us. Just like God corrected Abraham. I know what you were trying to do. I get what you're feeling about Ishmael. That's not the plan, Abraham. I get how you're feeling, Hawfields, about whatever. Fill in the blank. But here's the plan. No, we are going to get wrong. Unless somebody sitting in here can tell me that they are able to live a sinless, perfect life, we will get it wrong. Embrace it. Accept it. Fail forward. Because we can't get it right until we get it wrong. Thus, the origins of will begin with God. Our family tree begins with God. Our history moves because of God. Our salvation is assured because of God. The momentum of faith was set in motion by God to reach the end that God has in mind for us. And we need to be practicing reaching for God's will for ourselves, for others, for our town, for our state, for our country, for our world. We are part of something not only bigger than we are, but far more rich than we allow ourselves to believe. My brothers and sisters in Christ, let us see this, even if it doesn't always make sense to us. Amen. So our hymn of response is number 29, Begin My Tongue Some Heavenly Thing. And if it sounds unfamiliar, I promise the tune will be. Let us sing together. Let us say together this affirmation of faith. Take him from the brief statement of faith found in our book of confessions. Let us stand together. In life and in death, we belong to God. In the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, we trust
in the one triune God, the Holy One who is here,
who alone worships and serves. We trust in God, the Holy Spirit, everywhere the giver and renewer of life. The Spirit justifies us by grace through faith, sets us free to accept ourselves, to love God and neighbor, and binds us together with all believers in the one body of Christ, the Church. The same Spirit who inspired the prophets, the apostles, rules our faith and life in Christ through Scripture, engages us through the word proclaimed, claims us to the waters of baptism, feeds us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation, and calls us to begin to all ministries of the Church. In a broken and fearful world, the Spirit gives us courage to pray without ceasing, to witness among all peoples to Christ as Lord and Savior, to unmask idolatries in church and culture, to hear the voices of peoples long silenced, and to work with others for justice, freedom, and peace. In gratitude to God, empowered by the Spirit, we strive to serve Christ in our daily tasks, and to live holy and joyful lives, even as we watch for God to see heaven and to new earth. Pray, come, Lord Jesus. Believers in every time and place, we rejoice that nothing in life or in death can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. 1 John says that we are able to love because God first loved us.
We can show hospitality because God first showed it to us.
This table then is a symbol, and these elements are signs of not just the promise of God to us, but of the promise God makes in us for the world.
Friends, the scriptures say, they shall come from north and south and east and west to sit at the table God prepares. They shall come from happiness and heartbreak, from healthy and ill, from angry to joyful, from rich and poor, from faithful to doubtful, from wounded to healthy, and in this moment, be one church, one people.
And so let us rejoice today. Let us eat and drink together today. Let us live out the wonder of our creed today. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. With this in mind, let us join hands with one another as we will, and let us pray. We pray for those who are hungry.
We pray harder for those who will not feed them.
We pray for those who struggle each week to pay their bills.
We pray harder for those who could do something to help but don't care.
We pray for those who are homeless.
We pray harder for those who will not shelter them.
We pray for the sick and lonely.
We pray harder for those who will not give them comfort.
We pray for those who cry out for dignity.
We pray harder for those who will not listen.
We pray for those oppressed by unjust actions.
We pray harder for those exploiting them.
We pray for those whose voices diminish in their government.
We pray harder for those in office who ignore them.
We pray for those who are looking for the living God.
We pray harder for those of us who already claim to know Him.
We pray for those who should be gathered around a table like this.
We pray harder for those who hoard such gifts.
Bless us now, God, for Your sake.
Heal us all for the sake of the world.
And especially we pray this day for Rhonda Ward, who is expecting knee replacement surgery. We also pray for Patricia Knoll, who is recovering from knee replacement surgery. We also lift up to you continually Teresa Walls, who is still recovering at Peak Resources. We also pray for our staff person of the month, Nancy Apple, as she joins us and brings her gifts to bear on the task of ministry in our place. We also continue to pray for AB and for Ellen, for the Hurricane Florence victims, for Lugene, as well as Carol. We continue to pray for Elaine and her upcoming treatments at Duke. We also continue to pray for David. We pray for the upcoming midterm elections, as well as Bruce and Jerry. We give you great thanks, O God, for a great Community Days event and for so many who helped make it happen and so many who participated. May all of it have been a blessing to all. We also continue to pray for Mary and for Penny, for Tom and for Luann, for Lynette and for Susan, for George, for Pat and Tom. Lord God, we also continue to lift up ourselves to you, that we might continue to be ancestors for which you are proud, and ancestors for whom we have embraced your destiny. This we pray in the great name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
And thus, on the night in which he was betrayed, Jesus did take the bread, and after blessing it, broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, Take and eat. This is my body given for you. As often as you eat of it, do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, he took the cup, and after pouring it out, he blessed it, gave it to his disciples, and said, This cup is the new covenant, sealed in my blood for the forgiveness of many. All of you, drink of it. For as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's saving death until he comes. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. We do share the elements and we all hold them together and then we take them at the same time. We have gluten-free bread at the table. If that is a requirement for you, please raise your hand and that will be brought to you. This table and this meal are a reminder of what we should know. Chose to die for us. This table and this meal are a reminder of what we should do. Build, grow, and share. And in so living, help us demonstrate our thanks to you. Help us show we do not take your love for us, and your calling us as a church for granted. In the great name of Jesus Christ, let us love greatly. Amen. Our hymn of sending, hymn number 462, Come, Share the Lord. Evermore. Amen. get up and take heart. Jesus is calling you. Go in peace.
Thank you.